Thank you, and welcome. Good afternoon. My name is Linda Brooks Burton, and I'm happy to welcome you to the 12th Annual Unsung Hero Awards. We have been enjoying Bayview's own drumming sensation, Soundz From the Ground. Let's give them another hand. They were winners of this award in 1998, and we are delighted that they agreed to come in and perform for us this year. There's been a slight change in the program. We are going to have Robert Moses Kinn featuring Danielle Colding do their dance number at this moment, okay? So they are also playing tonight, or dancing tonight rather, at the Cowell Theater in Fort Mason. They have an 8 o'clock show. So if you could please welcome Danielle Colden. Thank you, Danielle. That was beautiful. Before I go any further, I am sure you have had a chance to read the program by now, and under the acknowledgement sections, there has been an omission of a very important person to this year's program. Aimme Holloway, herself a winner of this award in 1995, was instrumental in putting this program together before she took leave of San Francisco Public Library to move to Seattle in January. In fact, she was the one who actually put together this printed program, and she left her name off, being as modest as she is. So I would like us to give her a round of applause, even though she is not with us this afternoon. I meant to mention she was the librarian in the African American Center, the main library, for over 5 years. The Unsung Hero Awards originated at the Western Edition branch under the direction of Joan Jackson, the branch manager, who retired almost 2 years ago. Each year during Black History Month, San Francisco Public Library honors 10 winners selected from nominations made by community members. This year's winners include individuals who make significant contributions to several neighborhoods, including the Western Edition, Bayview Hunters Point, Ocean View, and Potrero Hill. These are people who give unselfishly of themselves to better their communities. We welcome the family and friends of our honorees. We want you to sit back and enjoy the program. We know you will leave here inspired by what you're about to experience. So let's get started. I would like to introduce a young woman who will be singing the Negro National Anthem. She is a senior at Mercy High School who sings lead in the chorus, in the school's chorus, and will be starring in her school's spring production of Pajama Game. She hopes to attend Carnegie Mellon or Boston's Conservatory of Music in the fall of this year. I believe we're in for quite a treat. Please welcome Aimme Rogers.
The dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of a new day, be gone. Let us march. Story is one. Thank you. You may be seated.
Thank you, Aimme. I would like to introduce now to you an old friend of the Unsung Heroes program. She was the mistress of ceremony for the 1998 program and shared those duties in the 1999 program. I thought I had given her a reprieve this year since she is expecting her second child in less than a month. But she insisted on being a part of this year's program as well, and we're happy to have her. Here is motivational cheerleader, our motivational cheerleader, Veronica Dangerfield.
Hello, y'all. Cousins, hello. I have missed you so much. And she, I was, I'm actually 9 months pregnant, and she says, you know, Veronica, I mean, I think that'll be too much for you to come up and, you know, do anything. It's like, please, Linda, please let me come. So I'd like to start out by saying Habari Gani. Can everybody say that with me? Habari Gani. Habari Gani means what's happening in Swahili. And you know that African Americans, we don't have a quiet tradition, we have a verbal tradition. And with that, I'd like all of you to say ashe.
Ashe.
Wait a minute, am I going deaf? I couldn't hear nothing. One more time.
Ashe.
Ashe. Is it a beautiful day today?
Yes.
Ashe. Do you feel like you're going to be blessed today? Oh, you are. We have some wonderful recipients today, and it is going to be a great program. So I want you all to do me a little promise. I want you to keep the energy up. I want you to get all of these hardworking recipients your love, like you're going to give it to me right now. Come on, let's practice. Oh, that's wonderful. I come to you bigger and better and more blessed than last year. And I know that each of you come to me bigger and better. One of the things that I wanted to talk about was Imani. Does anybody know what Imani means? Imani is faith. I was a faithless woman for 10 years because I didn't think I could ever have a child again. But then one day I decided that I was going to start taking prenatal vitamins. I was gonna get me an ovulation kit and I was gonna start acting like a pregnant woman and voila. And I bring that to you as an example of the faith that we can all have, because we're only gonna get what we believe, not what we deserve. So I'm asking you all from this moment on to high your expectations, because I believe in you and you should believe in each other. So what I'd like you to do right now, though, turn around and give your neighbor a Habari Gani. Because we cousins, this is all family. All right. A family reunion. Thank you so much for your attention. We have a very, very special treat today because we've got the youth emceeing the program. We're talking about not the potential of the future, but the future are here. Beautiful young people. The first one I'm going to introduce is Indira Mohamed. She's an eighth grader at Rooftop Alternative School, which is a very, very special school in San Francisco. So we know that she's already where she is school president, secretary of the dance committee, and serves as the graduation advisory committee. Indira is a beautiful girl, and she also has a modeling career. So when Indira comes up here, you guys give her your love and support, okay? And we also have another very young MC. His name is Christopher. He's 11 years old, and he's a student at the Marina Middle School. He's on the soccer team, track team, and his favorite subject is science. Can I hear Ashe for his favorite subject? Ashe, we need our kids in science. He's also an avid reader. So I would like you, I'm gonna come back up again because y'all ain't getting rid of me that fast, okay? Okay, Ashe. And what I'd like you to do is give them your warm attention and give them your energy because they're very young and this isn't easy for them, but they're gonna do a wonderful job. And God bless each and every one of the recipients. We are privileged and honored to have you. And every single person in here has a secret that God only knows about, where they have helped somebody else, where they have done something, where they are an unsung hero. And I would like to give you my ashe. All right. So Indira, come on up here, dear, and do your thing. See y'all in a minute.
Hi, my name is Indira Mohamed, and I'm going to be one of the presenters today. The first unsung hero I would like to introduce is Marcus Cook, who is unfortunately not here today, but his sister Marquette will be accepting his award. Marcus Cook is a young man with a bright future. As a volunteer cadet tutor for the Saturday Literacy Academy sponsored by the San Francisco Unified School District and the Alliance of Black Educators, Marcus volunteered his time every Saturday morning for 3 years to tutor students in reading in reading at Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Middle School. His teacher, Mrs. Virginia P. Marshall, nominated him for this Unsung Hero Award. You could see the patience and love in his face as he worked with students from in grades kindergarten to fifth from various elementary schools in the area, Mrs. Marshall wrote. You could see the struggle at first, but ultimately improved their reading and self-esteem. If we listen to news reports, it looks as if the generation of our African-American boys are lost, Mrs. Marshall continued. Oh, if we could only clone Marcus. Marcus is now studying sports medicine at Pepperdine University. His mentorship of young children in the San Francisco African-American community has earned him an Unsung Hero Award. We're looking forward to following this bright young man as he begins his career. Marcus Cook, Unsung Hero for 2000. And this is his sister Marquette accepting this award for him. Our next hero is Reverend Billy Ware, who has lived in the Bayview community for over 30 years. He has been a volunteer chaplain for the San Francisco Sheriff's Department for 15 years and has only recently become a paid chaplain. He has also been the associate minister for Third Baptist Church for the last 15 years. According to his son, Larry Ware, Reverend Ware has been a positive influence in the community and those who have been imprisoned. He has been counseling prisoners, encouraging them to be constructive members of society. He takes care of many tasks for the inmates and their families, assisting them with finding jobs, performing marriages, funerals, and counseling services. At San Quentin Prison Ranch, Reverend Ware ministers the men in a seminar setting four times a year. He teaches a class at San Bruno County Jail No. 7 every Thursday and Sunday evening and also performs religious services every Sunday. His wife, Mrs. Ware, is also involved in the ministry, doing a service for those incarcerated in County Jail No. 8 on Fridays. In addition, Reverend Ware and his team of volunteers have fed the San Bruno County Jail No. 7 with a full course meal at Thanksgiving since 1989. He also provides food baskets for the needy year-round, and all this is done with private donations. Recently, Reverend Ware has founded a nonprofit organization called Crossroads Charitable Foundation to assist him with all the wonderful things he does for the community, such as providing bikes to many boys and girls who cannot afford them. Reverend Ware is the father of 5, grandfather of 15, and great-grandfather of 4. Please help me welcome to the stage Reverend Billy Ware.
Hello. My name is Reverend Billy Ware. I would rather say I'm your servant and a slave of Jesus Christ. I want to thank all who had a part of this and has made it possible. Throughout the years of my volunteers who have pushed me to the limit, I want to thank them all. And all of my supporters who are here today, I want to thank you. Most of all, I'd like to thank God and Pastor Supervisor Amos Brown and Mayor Willie Brown for being my supporters and my mentor for all the things that God has enabled me to do. I want to thank my little wife sitting there, Maxine, for her support. Oh, I'm sorry, my son Larry Ware, thank you.
Dr. George W. Davis has been the executive director for the Bayview Hunters Point Multipurpose Senior Service since 1978. This is the first African-American owned and operated senior citizen center in Northern California. His friend and colleague who nominated him for this award, Mr. Louis Jean-Pierre, states, Dr. Davis operates the Bayview Hunters Point Senior Program, serving numerous seniors in areas of dietary, physical, mental, and social therapy with programs in a quiet but effective way. Dr. Davis also developed a national advocacy organization to provide outreach and advocacy for African-American elders throughout the United States. Presently, he is working on initiating and organizing support for an aging campus project to be implemented in the Bayview Hunters Point area. Besides advocating for elders, Dr. Davis is a spiritual leader. He has been the pastor at the Metropolitan Baptist Church for the past 7 years, where he provides spiritual support for congregation, including ministry to elders and youth. Please welcome Dr. George W. Davis.
Just allow me to make one correction. I'm an associate minister at Metropolitan Baptist Church and not the pastor. So I really pay homage and give respect to my pastor, who is Reverend Shad Reddick. But I would not be standing here before you had it not been for the seniors that I've had the privilege of serving for the past 22 years. It's through their blood, sweat, and tears and the trials and tribulations that they had to overcome that I was able to be privileged to stand on their shoulders, that I might serve them and do programs for them. I really want to thank Mr. Andrew Jean-Pierre for nominating me for this award, and I feel so precious that I'm in such good company of other nominees, for they have suffered and toiled through the years, because it's a difficult task sometimes serving those who nobody else wants to serve. Again, thank you so very much.
I'm sorry, there was a change and I have to do my other two. Okay, Alex Humphrey Sr. Alex Humphrey did not have an easy time of it growing up. He has lived in the public housing projects for most of his young life and has been selling drugs and began selling drugs at the tender age of 8. His juvenile record includes possession of cocaine and marijuana with intent to sell, as well as burglary and petty theft. As a young adult, he continued to show up on the wrong side of the law, adding possession of a firearm and conspiracy to his record. It was not until he became a father that he considered turning his life around. Another turning point for Alex came when he met Reverend Cecil Williams on a march to Valencia Gardens, the housing projects where Alex lived at the time. I knew immediately that Alex was someone who could help bring children, teenagers, and adults together, says Reverend Williams about Alex, and this is exactly what he has been doing for the past 10 years. Alex has worked with various organizations from Glide Memorial to the Economic Opportunity Council. He is so committed to the community that he is presently initiating his own organization to provide youth with some of the same opportunities that he was given before they end up in the criminal justice system. Alex is putting together a democratic club for residents of the San Francisco public housing to empower disenfranchised voters in these areas. The key people that Alex points out as being important to in his transformation are Reverend Williams, Cecil Williams, and Ray Balbron, a mentor who guided him through some rough patches, but his son, Alex Jr., and his daughter, Chardon, who are driving force in his life and whom he gets his strength. His children are also the ones who nominated him for this award. Would Alex Jr. and Chardon please come up to the stage? I'm sorry, her name is Chardonnay. Alex, do you want to read the nomination that won your father this award?
Yes. Okay. My dad loves me and my sisters very much, and he gives us lots of love. My dad does a lot to help people in our communities, but never really get paid for it. My dad always says that even though he doesn't get paid, that for helping people, if you can really help someone, somebody in their life, then you always feel like $1 million in the end, which is payment enough. But I still don't understand what he means. Even though my dad always documents his work, he never really gets recognition. My dad said that when he was young, he did a lot of bad things, but now he's older and trying to help rebuild our communities, to help make life better for other people and children. My dad always volunteers at my school because he says he loves children. My dad says that if you have to love other people's children in order to love your own children. My dad is our hero, and we want him to be your hero, too. Thank you.
And now welcome our youngest unsung hero, Mr. Alex Humphrey, Sr.
It's always a blessing to know that you could be a leader through example. And excuse me. You know, I think back to what I went through in my younger years. I never really had my father, and I never really had my mother. And I went through so much that I remember there was a point in my life where just life got really tiring. And I remember actually feeling having a feeling of actually not wanting to be here anymore in my younger years. And was fascinated with this thing about going out like a soldier and dying like a man. But it wasn't until I seen the birth of my son that I opened up my eyes and seen life in a different way and realized then that I wanted to live like a man instead of die like one. I know that it wasn't until like 10 years ago that I had met Cecil Williams through one of the housing developments in Valencia Gardens that he provided an opportunity for me to rehabilitate my whole way of living. I know that a lot of times when you're out there committing certain acts, people don't really want to take the time with you. But, you know, I've been on my own since 15 years old. That's how old I was when I had my first apartment. And back then, you didn't even qualify for a summer job unless you had a summer's permit. But Cecil Williams, along with his organization, when they did a march through the public housing development, provided that opportunity. And he said, man, he said, we have something here. He said, and that's when he took me up under his wing and I started working with him and his organization over at Glide. So I really want to thank him for that. Really want to thank him for the opportunity to give me the opportunity to work with him instead of for him. It was really important for me. It's funny because I wrote a couple of things down on here that I didn't want to forget to mention. And because all of what's happened, I can't even see the words on this paper. But I just want to thank my son and my daughter very much for nominating me. I want to thank the committee for electing me as the group of people who for the Unsung Heroes Award today. It means a lot to me. And I want to thank Reverend Williams. I want to thank Ray Balbron, Jacqueline Keys, and Leon Beck Hughes, who have, in one way or the other, been very instrumental in my life. I also want to thank Nathaniel Mason Jr. He also deserves recognition for where I'm at today. Thanks again. God bless.
Mrs. Moses Curry has just turned 80 years old. According to Barbara Brown, who nominated her for this award, Mama Curry is a pioneer in Bayview Hunters Point community. She is presently retired from the Economic Opportunity Council War on Poverty program, where she worked for 35 years. She worked at the E.O.C. in many capacities, from coordinator to a social worker. She is still very active in her community, serving as chair on one of the committees for Network for Elders. She is also a board member at the Community Advisory Board of United Council of Human Services, where she has served since it was founded 18 years ago. She was recently featured in Essence magazine highlighting her community spirit. She is a member of St. James Baptist Church, and she has been for over 50 years. And she is considered a Mama Curry to all who know her. Mama Curry is the mother of 8, grandmother of 24, and great-grandmother of 14. Please welcome a true mother of the community, Mrs. Moses Mama Curry.
Big cry baby, but I'm not gonna cry today because I feel so good. I mean, it makes me feel real good for what's happening to me today. And I just don't know almost what to say because I feel good. I feel real good. And I have worked in the community a long, long time, and I'm still working, and everybody telling me I should sit down. But I can't sit down. If I sit down, that's when I close my eyes. So I want to keep on going. And I'm just proud. I'm just so happy today. I'm real happy. And I want to thank Ms. King and also my loving Bobby Brown. Mother Bobby Brown, because she is really the cousin of me here. And she really got me to going a lot, got me going now in the community working, because I can't stop, because she wants me to do a lot of things, and I want to do a lot of things for the community. And I love the youth. I really love the youth. I would go down with the youth. I have been down to City Hall day and night, working with the young people. I have young people, I have 8 kids, but one have deceased, and I have those 22 grandkids and have the great grandkids. And I still don't want to stop working because I'm for the community, and I have worked all over San Francisco, all the communities, and tried to do my part. And I think that I'm going to have to continue on. But I thanks the Lord to let me be here today. Thanks, Sister King and Sister Mother Brown. And we got a lot of things going with Mother Brown, and I know I can't stop until the end. So we're going to have a lot of things in Hunter's Point to have for everybody. And that's what I like about it. Everybody have something that we help. And I want to thank the committee and also, I don't know her name. What's your name? Who? Linda. And I want to thank Linda because she encouraged me a lot too, and my daughter used to work with her. So I want to thank everybody to be an unsung. I really don't know how I feel today because, you know, I couldn't see people appreciate me doing anything. And when I got this, I really appreciate it. And my next reward will be heaven above. And I want to thank you.
Cousins, if you're 80 years old, would you like to look like that? Is she beautiful? She's resplendent. And I also want you to put your hands together and give some love to Adira. She did a wonderful job. Came up with confidence and did your thing. You go, girl. So right now, we're gonna have the drummers come back up. We're gonna have a 10-minute intermission. Please, nobody leave, because I got some guards outside the door, and we're willing to hunt you down, because we have a lot more marvelous program to have, and I want you to benefit from the privilege of being here. So take 10 minutes, get some fresh air, get some water, go to a little girls or boys' room, and come on back, okay? As we convene for the second half of the Unsung Heroes Awards, I just want to comment on the inspiration that we've seen. The contributions from Mother, she's been doing it for 35 years. Can you imagine service for 35 years? And she looks so wonderful. And Christopher's young children nominate, the young children came up and nominated their dad. They asked if they could nominate their dad. And that's just amazing when the children can admire their parents. What an exceptional role model. Can I hear an Ashe in the audience? Ashe. And now, We have more talent coming up. We've got a young man, Christopher. He's 11 years old, and he's gorgeous. He's a student at Marina Middle School. He's an athlete, soccer, track, and his favorite sport is science. And he goes all over the world and can be anything he wants to be because he's an avid reader. And I just want to give thumbs up to the San Francisco Public Library, who gave you this wonderful program today. Can I hear an ashe? The San Francisco Public Library. You know, that's all you need is a library card, and you can go anywhere in the world. You can become self-taught like Benjamin Banneker. He was taught to read by the Quakers, but he became an astronomer, a civil engineer. He became a surveyor. He actually put the road plans for Washington, D.C., and he taught himself. San Francisco Public Library, we love you! Yes! And now, with no further ado, let's bring Christopher on. Come up, Christopher. Give him some love, y'all.
Hello. The person I will be introducing to you today, named LaVerne Hawkins. A product of Western addiction, LaVerne Hawkins has devoted her life to the love of children. Currently a site manager for the Young African American Achievers Program, a parent liaison with Benjamin Franklin Middle School, and a parent advocate with Parent Advocacy for Youth. Ms. Hawkins is dedicated to helping support parents and students. It is our pleasure to welcome Ms. LaVerne Hawkins.
That's all right. Okay.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Wish you the best.
Thank you. I want to thank God for just putting certain people in my life. I have a very supportive staff at Ben Franklin Middle School, Ms. Swartz, Mr. Greener, Ms. Smith. I don't know what I'd do without Maria Chin, Stella Lamb, James, Mary, Jean Breed, The Beacon, and my six children, five who have come through Ben. I owe a lot to education for my grandbaby. I don't want her to have to go through some of the struggles that I've had to go through with my own children. I think what actually helped me and turned my life around is my child that's in special ed. I never knew when you go into a meeting how many people went in with negative thoughts. It was always our fault, never the system. I got with Komen's Advocacy for Children and Youth, and I became a parent advocate for children. I now have a video out that teaches parents what I didn't know, and it's me. I understand a lot with children, and if I can't help but one child a day or talk to one parent, I've been there. My life is no bed of roses. But until the day I die, I want to make sure that all children are treated equal, that they understand, and that parents don't have to stand in the background and keep their mouths closed, because a closed mouth don't get fed. And last, my sister. We've been through a lot. I'm still going through a lot, and she's always there for me. I have a brother, and I love him, but can nobody take the love that I have for me and my sister? And I say to all sisters and brothers, aunties, cousins, the best thing you can do for yourself is to love one another. Thank you.
Originally from Danville, Illinois, Shelly Danridge has made her mark in San Francisco, tirelessly devoting her time to the volunteer services, currently a staff analyst with California State Office of Family Court Services. Ms. Danridge has a long history of donating her services to work with children and adults for organizations that include the San Francisco Youth Center and the San Francisco Cooperative Restraining Order Clinic. Please welcome Ms. Shelly Danridge.
I would like to thank the selection committee from the Unsung Hero Program and the San Francisco Public Library and the Friends and Foundation of the San Francisco Library. I'm truly honored to receive this award. Many nights when I go to clinic after a long day of being at court, it's very tiring, but I really have to thank I call him my other half, but he's really my better half, and that's Paul Silva. I want to thank him for his patience and his understanding, because he has more understanding than any human being should ever have. The many times he picks me up late at night, and the many times I say, oh, I'm going to be ready at 8 o'clock, or 9 o'clock, or 10 o'clock, or 11 o'clock, and he's constantly waiting outside for me, sometimes for an hour. And so I really want to tell him thank you. I thank you, and I thank you, the women at the clinic, thank you. And I want to thank Miss Maggie Agee, who I've known for 15 years, who's been like a mom to me. And I want to thank Dorothy Scott. I don't see her here, but I know she's here. There she is. This woman is not only my best friend, but she's been like my mom. She's a woman who truly inspires me to do the things that I do. It's through her encouragement and her compassion that I was able to finish law school, that I was able to do the things that I do. And when I sit on the San Mateo Council for Domestic Violence, I think about all the things she's helped me to do and to be here today. And I also want to acknowledge the National Council of Negro Women. The organization, they're also sponsoring the reception, and they're also a sponsor of the Unsung Hero Program. But I want to acknowledge the many women I work with at the National Council of Negro Women. This is truly a wonderful, wonderful organization to belong to. For all the women out there, and we also accept men as associate members, if you don't belong to the National Council of Negro Women, I stand here today and tell you to join the organization. It's a wonderful, wonderful organization who not only works to help improve the quality of life for African American women, but also for the communities. Also, I'm just so touched, I can't believe it. But also, just not only for African American women, but also for their families and for the community in general. And I accept this award with a lot of pride, but I'm gonna dedicate my award to the true unsung heroes who are not present here today. And that's the many women who are survivors of domestic violence. If you don't know, I want to tell you there are more than 4 million women who are physically abused every year who are victims of domestic violence. That means every 15 seconds, a woman is being beaten in this country. And so I ask you, as you sit here today and you honor me, what I'd like for you to do is help me and my work as I commit to end violence in the lives of women. I ask you that you volunteer either in a shelter, or you volunteer to work on the crisis line, or you organize with your community. You can do simple things such as place a sticker in your window so that a woman who may be your neighbor, who may be in a violent relationship, will know that your house is a safe house. Also, talk to your pastors in the community and let them know that October is Domestic Violence Month and that there's things you can do in your community to end violence. And so the work I do and this award is truly to the many survivors of domestic violence. Thanks a lot.
Although born in Detroit, James Mabrie was raised in San Francisco and has been a fixture at Benjamin Franklin Middle School for almost 20 years. Known to the students as the Great One, Mr. Mabrie, a security aide, has been an unofficial mentor, volunteering his off hours as a tutor for graduating students and assisting young musicians for Ben Franklin's award-winning band. Please welcome Mr. James Mabrie.
First off, I'd like to thank God for being here today, and I'd like to thank him for making it possible for me to receive this award. And like he said, I've been in the band for almost 20 years, and I enjoyed my work too with the kids. I like helping the kids. I try to say positive things to them, try to be a role model to them. And I'd like to thank the staff at Benjamin Franklin, the counselors, the teachers, the principal, the vice principal, the secretaries, the custodians, you know, everybody. If it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be receiving this award here today. And I would like to thank one other person, Maria Chen, for nominating me for this award. God bless everybody and peace in your life.
Christopher, you did an extraordinary job. Let's get an ashe out and a big round of applause. What confidence, he's only 10. Gee whiz. And now we have a very, very, very special treat. As they say in the Bible, and a child shall lead them, the children will continue to lead. We have Javan and Simone Gardiner. I pronounced it right a minute ago. One is 11 years old and the other one is 9. Javan is a fifth grader at Jose Ortega Elementary School, where he is an excellent student. He enjoys Pokemon. How many parents have heard of that? Computer, basketball, and dancing. He plays the drums and the congo, and he is a great all-around kid. Now, Simone attends Jose Ortega as well with her brother. She's an Aquarian. She's carefree, loving, and likes people. A leader in her class, she loves to read, work on computers, and to organize things. When she grows up, she intends to be not only a medical doctor, but a veterinarian. So she's gonna take care of the whole world. How about that, huh, Shay? Can you welcome Javan and Simone? Thank you. that was absolutely awesome, wasn't it? Let's put our hands together for the parents of these children, all of them. God bless you. In the lost and found department, there's some keys to afford, unless, is this what I get for being the MC today? If you're looking for your keys, I have them. There's also a one pearl earring. If you're looking for it, I got it. And now, my dear friends, we're gonna continue with the awards. And the next award is for Ms. Cleo Farrell Cummings. Ms. Cleo Farrell Cummings, the soul and spirit of Sheridan Elementary School, one who believes that every child is her own, who treats every child as her own with dignity, compassion, and a firm hand that is both guiding and correcting. Ooh, I should hear an ashe somewhere in the audience. Ashe. Ms. Cummings was born in Atlanta, Georgia, and came to California with her parents in 1940. They settled in the OMI district of San Francisco. She married and reproduced wealthily. She had six children. All six of her children are alive and well and reside in the Bay Area. And Ms. Cummings is widowed. She received her master's degree in education from San Francisco State University and has worked in the San Francisco Unified School District for over 40 years. She worked her way up from kindergarten onto the school grounds. She's taught at Sacred Heart, E.R. Taylor, and the New Traditional School. 8 years ago, she was appointed the principal of Sheridan. Ms. Cummings is one of a kind and will take the action that the situation demands. Let me demonstrate the grit and determination of this very fine and unique individual. Have you ever watched a reckless driver wind his way through the OMI? Not stopping at stop signs, turning corners on two wheels, and disregarding the myriad of traffic regulations. OMI residents just creep along in their cars, hoping and praying they will not encounter such a driver today. But who's the crazy band of people standing in the middle of the street in front of Sheridan School directing traffic? Well, that's Ms. Cumming and her crew. Sheridan School has just let out, and they're making sure that no child gets hit by a car. Can I hear an ashe? Ashe. Mrs. Cleo Farrings Cummings unfortunately could not be here today, but we do have someone who, Darcus who? Darcus Thomas is going to accept the award for her. Please welcome her. Thank you.
Thank you. I will give this award to Mrs. Cummings. I first met Mrs. Cummings about 10 years ago when I was a tutor. We were tutoring the children at Sheridan School, and she came with the children. And since that time, she has been a part of my life. Now I work as a volunteer at Sheridan, and I keep the library for her. Believe me, Mrs. Cummings is a very wonderful woman.
And last but not least, certainly not least, Edna M. James. Edna James is a mover and a shaker. She was chairperson of the OMI Community Association Health Committee from 1972 to 1975. She's been on various boards, including the San Francisco Commission on Aging, the San Francisco Comprehensive Health Planning Council, and the Child Abuse Council. She's planned and implemented excuse me, innovative programs for youth, including health career forums and recruitments for high school students. She's worked to provide funding for transportation services for senior citizens. According to Agnes Morton, who nominated her, Ms. James has worked very hard to help restore the economic, educational, and social viability of the OMI community. Can I hear an ashe out there, cousins? Ashe. She is currently actively involved with the Library Committee for the New Ocean View Branch. Mrs. James, for your years of tireless effort on behalf of our community, thank you for being a 2000 recipient of the Unsung Heroes. If you'd like to come up, we'd love to give it to you.
I'm gonna be like the other lady. You kind of want to cry, but we'll make it. I'm very honored today to receive this award, and I would like to thank the committee and my fellow nursing person, Agnes Martin, and Darcus Thomas, and the OMI community. I want to say that I was listening to a program from Oprah Winfrey, and she was talking about millionaires and what it means to be a millionaire. And I almost called Regis myself about being a millionaire, you know, and I said, well, I may not understand the questions. But then it came out that it was not about the money. It was about giving. It's about giving of yourself to others. And even people who had the money were not happy. And I'd just like to say that there's sometimes that, you know, it's never about the money. It's about making other people happy, and particularly young people. I'm the mother of five kids, all have finished college. I have a son who's a doctor, and one's an engineer, and my daughter's in law school. And I'm very proud to work with children. I've been very partial to boys because I had four boys and one girl, because I think they need a lot of, people have accused me of being concerned about the young men more than I was the young women. But I'm very partial to boys because I had children who were in the gifted program as well as one was in special ed. And I understand the young lady who talked before about speaking out for your children and understanding what it's all about. And I'm very proud to have been a part of the public school system. Also, my interest has been in the health field. I remember graduating from the University of California master's program in nursing and just talking about the health care, not only of older people. And as we talk about closing the gap in health care, we talk about older people. The leading causes of death among African Americans. We talk about heart disease, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, cancer. There's a gap there, and I'm willing to use all the energy that I can to look at closing that gap in healthcare. And of course, for our young people, when we look at AIDS and homicide in the Black community, is very concerned about that, because we lose a lot of young people in that area, and I'm committed to that. Dr. George Davis, I'm very humbled to be on a roll with him, because when we opened up the daycare, I was the first nurse there. Looked like sometimes we didn't almost make payroll, but we were still working and making it a reality in the Bayview community. And I've been very proud to be a part of that first nurse in the Bayview community. I'm also a part of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, which is a public service sorority. And we do give scholarships, and I'm part of the chair of the Social Action Committee. And I'm glad to hear my two colleagues here, Colleen and Crystal Tunsil, here to support me. And we had a meeting today, so I say, let's just meet at the library, because we have a meeting about some issues that we have to make for Delta Sigma Theta. And the OMI community, I'm very proud to be a part of the OMI community and what we're trying to do, and focus in on the healthcare needs as well as the education and cultural needs. We did go to the mayor and say, we need a new library, and we got our new library, and we're very happy and proud of that. So the mayor gave us a new library. And also, we're working on Ocean Avenue and the redevelopment of Ocean Avenue. I know my field is in healthcare, but I'm all across the board. I remember UC say, Edna, you're all across the board. I say, well, you know, the needs of Black people is all across the board, so I have to be all across the board. And so I'm very proud of that. I remember when I was in the graduate program at UC, the paper came out to interview us, and I was I thought it was going to be an interview about what all I was doing in the community. But what she said, she's a troublemaker, and she likes it. So if it means trouble that I'm advocating for the African-American community, I like it. And thank you very much for this award.
For all the unsung heroes that we awarded today, and for every single one of you here, because I know that you're a hero. And if you don't think you're a hero, I believe you're a hero, and I know you're a hero, so you don't have to believe it. Just know that I know it. And hopefully that's enough for you. And I would like to end with what Martin Luther King said shortly before he was assassinated. And he said this, and I feel like every single one of the unsung heroes are a part of this quote. He said, to say that I was a drum major for justice, say that I was a drum major for peace, that I was a drum major for righteousness, and all of the other shallow things will not matter. I won't have to leave any money behind. I won't have the fine and luxurious things of life to leave behind, but I just wanted to leave a committed life behind. I would like to thank each of the unsung heroes for leaving a committed life behind. My name is Veronica Dangerfield. It has been my privilege and my honor to be with you here today. Ashe, and I love you.
Well, this program ran in record time. And I'm sure everybody got something out of it. It was very inspirational for me to hear all the unsung heroes speak and accept their awards. So in closing, though, I would like to introduce the staff, the committee that I work with. I did not do this on my own. I had help from fellow librarians. And this is Toba Singer from Patrol Hill. Dorothy Coakley from Ocean View, the new library that's going to be opening. Okay, wait. And Robert Carlson from Western Edition. I'd like to turn the mic over to Toba, who has a few words she'd like to say.
Good afternoon. I want to say that today was seen as an event that's celebratory of the commitment and achievements and contributions that individuals in the African-American community make toward their community and towards the betterment of life for everyone who lives in this nation. I don't think, though, that we can walk out of today's event without noting a setback for all of us, which was the unconscionable decision in the Amadou Diallo case, which came down just a few days ago. And I think that the challenge is before the youth that are here with us today to set that right and to take the talents and commitment and courage that they have into the streets, to our president, and demand that our president, William Jefferson Clinton, reverse this horrible decision which gives the green light to police brutality, something that most of us in this audience have fought for the last 30 or 40 years, and some of us longer. So I call on all of you to leave today's meeting with that in mind. Thank you.
And Dorothy would like to say a few things.
I'm talking to you about Ocean View. Last year at this time, I stood in front of you and said, in Ocean View, we're building tomorrow one child at a time. This year, I'd like to invite you to the opening of the new Ocean View branch, which will be in June. And I would like to tell you that as of last week, we've purchased probably one of the finest African-American film collections in San Francisco and probably the West Coast. And for the final thing, and this really is you, and this is Darcus, who's out there and who was the former librarian at Ocean View, our goal was to raise $175,000 to furnish the Ocean View branch with computers and so forth and so on. And that was our commitment to the mayor who put the building together and got the money for that. We closed at $450,000. Okay. So thank all of you.
I would just like to acknowledge a few more people. I would like to thank our young MCs, Indira and Christopher. They did a wonderful job. And our veteran
MC Veronica Dangerfield. Can we just give her a hand? She was wonderful. Thank you. I would also like you to acknowledge three members of our nominating committee who are here today. And if you would just raise your hand, that'd be fine. Dorothy Strickland in the back there, Darcus Thomas right next to her, and Hazel King, who has been a winner also of this award in the past. Thank you, ladies. I'd also like to thank my children's librarian from Bayview Branch. He's been sitting here taking pictures. Thank you, Denise, for offering. This is Bayview's children's librarian. All the talent today was wonderful. Soundz From the Ground, Javan and Simone, Robert Moses and Ken, we had wonderful talent, and I appreciate them coming out and doing that for us. And lastly, I'd like to thank the National Council of Negro Women who are sponsoring the reception that you will be enjoying really soon. They have been doing this for the last 12 years. They are an integral part of this program, and they do it unselfishly and willingly. So you will be enjoying some good food when you leave this auditorium in a few minutes. I'd like to call up Soundz From the Ground, though, to kind of drum us out for our last procession. Oh, I'm sorry, Robert Carlson has something to say.
I would like to say to all of you that all of this would not be possible without the hard work of Linda Brooks Burton, who did the coordinating for all of this. And as you can see, this was quite a success once again this year. Let's give a great round of applause to Linda Brooks Burton.
Well, thank you very much. It's my pleasure. Soundz From the Ground, one more time.